May 1st, 1960, 1,300 miles into Soviet airspace, an American U-2 spy plane was flying at 65,000 feet, out of range, in theory, from Soviet missiles. But then, at 8:23 a.m. Moscow time, the pilot, Gary Powers, felt the dull thump of a missile exploding nearby.
I felt the aircraft jerk forwards. I saw a tremendous flash light the cockpit in the sky, and I thought, oh boy, I've had it now.
For the Soviets, this proof that America had invaded their airspace was a major propaganda triumph. Khrushchev told the world, "We've got the pilot." But it was America, not just Powers, they put in the dock. The incident brought into focus the real nature of the Cold War. Not a war fought on the battlefield, but a war of espionage, a war of propaganda, a war of arms race bluff and counter bluff. Gary Powers spent 3 years in a Soviet jail, time enough to mull over his version of Operation Overflight. This program reconstructs the memoirs he published after his release.
I was just 16 at the end of World War II. Seemed like I'd been born too late for the important things. My daddy wanted me to go down a mine like he'd done, live my life down in some Kentucky mine, but I didn't want to do that. I wanted to fly. Knew it since I was a kid. As soon as I could, I made the break. Joined the U.S. Air Force, 2 years in training, 2 years in fighters. But then, this is in 1955, I was told to report to a man. His name was Collins. I was told they had me in mind for something special.
It'll be risky, but it's patriotic. You'll be doing something important for your country.
I'd like that, sir.
Yes, I'm sure you would.
He was an Air Force, that was obvious. He explained he was CIA from the Central Intelligence Agency. Nobody had ever heard of him then. I just knew they were some super secret branch of the government. He explained to me that if I accepted the mission, they'd be my paymasters too. And thus, I suppose, spies are made.
You'll want to know what it's about. You will, of course, respect the classified nature of what you're about to hear. First, you've been selected with several other pilots to check out an entirely new aircraft, a plane which will fly at altitudes higher than any plane ever flown. Are you interested?
I was interested. Flying higher than anyone ever flown, what pilot could resist that? But that was nothing to what came next.
Once you've completed your training, we'll send you overseas. Part of your job will be to make reconnaissance flights along the Russian border. You will carry equipment monitoring radar and radio signals. But that's just part of it. Your main mission will be to fly over Russia itself.
I tell you, I was stunned. I sat there listening to him describing these overflights, describing the cameras that would photograph Russia's defenses. I could not believe my ears.
What Powers was hearing was a new twist in an old game, espionage. The art of spying on your enemy. Soviet Russia was a closed society, as much under Khrushchev as Stalin before him. Western observers were watched closely on Soviet soil, shown only what the Russians wanted them to see. Publicly, the Americans condemned espionage as a dirty game. But without it, they faced an enemy about which they knew very little.
There are huge areas of Russia that are simply a mystery to us. Industrial complexes, military complexes, whole cities that have grown up behind the Urals since World War II. Outsiders haven't even seen them. To be frank with you, we have no idea what Russia's planning militarily, what she's capable of, what we must be prepared to meet should war come. Operation Overflight has been conceived to close that gap.
In 1955, an air display in Moscow had alerted Western observers to the possible scale of the Soviet threat. Wave after wave of bombers had flown overhead, each capable of carrying a nuclear payload to the United States. In this nuclear game, numbers was all. The more bombers you had, the greater your chances of slipping one through the enemy's defenses. America had begun to fear a bomber gap, an imbalance in Russia's favor.
It's difficult to explain exactly what I felt at that moment, Collins describing to me my mission. But mostly, you know, I think it was relief that at last America was on the offensive once again. We're fighting a real war with very real objectives, and yet for many years we'd seen nothing but stalemate and compromise, a free world losing to communism. To be told that the government of the United States of America had dreamed up an intelligence operation so gutsy, so daring, well, it restored my faith in the alertness of that government. I was amazed, and I was immensely proud.
This is the earliest known film of the plane that made overflights possible, the Lockheed U-2. A bizarre hybrid of jet and glider, able to fly up to 70,000 feet for more than 3,000 miles. That high up, in theory, the planes were safe from both jet fighters and ground-fired missiles, leaving them free to do their job, photographing systematically every inch of the Soviet Union, for analysis later by intelligence experts in Washington. Their first success was in exploding the myth of the so-called bomber gap.
It was pure propaganda, just an elaborate hoax. They had one squadron of bombers they'd move around, so they'd pop up in places Westerners could spot them. And as for the flyby, well, presumably, after the plane had passed by overhead, they did circle on around and join the back of the queue. There was something else our photos revealed too, which is far more worrying. While we were busting a gut fretting over the bomber gap, the Russians had shifted their emphasis to missiles.
The missile gap, the belief that Russia had outstripped the West in missile technology, preoccupied America from 1957 to the early 1960s. It mattered because missiles made bombers redundant. If powerful enough, they could deliver nuclear warheads across whole continents. In 1957, to the delight of the Soviet people, Russian scientists used missile technology to launch Sputnik, the world's first satellite, into space. Propaganda hailed the dawn of the space age, in which for many years the Soviets would take the lead. But the gloss disguised a tougher message too, that Soviet technology had caught up with, even outstripped, technology in the West, and that the same technology used to launch a tiny metal ball into space could also be used to launch missiles at America.
I can't tell you how much it hurt us. It was a blow to our pride. I remember on the radio, you pick up Sputnik transmitting this beep, beep. Apparently in Moscow, Russians would approach Westerners, smile, and say beep, beep, as if to say, you're slipping behind. Don't you forget it.
In America, a crisis of self-confidence led to calls for investment in civil defense. Air raid drills were held regularly. The Washington Post rammed the point home.
We're in the gravest danger in our history, under threat from a missile-bristling Soviet Union. We must close this missile gap and counter the worldwide communist offensive.
For the pilots on the U-2 program, the fear of the missile gap gave their missions an increased sense of importance.
Bit by bit, overflight by overflight, we're penetrating and dispersing a cloud of ignorance which for decades made the Soviet Union a dark and shadowy land. We are revealing for the first time a complete picture of military Russia. Atomic production sites, oil storage depots, submarine yards, railroads, missile factories, launch sites, radar installations, anti-aircraft defenses. If Khrushchev sneezes, we know about it. You boys got any questions?
Of course, truth was we all had one burning question, but none of us would ask it. If the Russians had the missile capability to put a satellite into space, it wouldn't be long before they had the capability to knock a U-2 out of the sky. The question none of us asked was, what then? We just let ourselves believe there was a plan to deal with that eventuality.
In 1959, Nikita Khrushchev visited America, the first Soviet premier to do so. Always jovial, his air of self-confidence was noted by the American people. By contrast, Dwight Eisenhower, the American president, was suffering ill health and a slump in the polls. People said this old soldier had gone soft on the Soviets. Pressured to increase defense spending, he did so only grudgingly, and no one could understand why. But the fact was, again, the picture was blurred with half-truths. Even the U-2 pilots believed the myth of the missile gap. But it was a myth, just like the bomber gap hoax before it. Analysis in Washington of the U-2 photographs showed a Soviet missile program plagued by setbacks. By 1960, they had only about 30 intercontinental ballistic missiles ready, not enough to justify panic in America. Eisenhower knew the facts. He knew massive defense spending could only increase Cold War tensions. But he couldn't tell the public what he knew without revealing the existence of the U-2 program. Not that it was to make much difference, because in May 1960, the U-2 program was to explode into public consciousness, whether Eisenhower liked it or not.
I remember every detail. Filling my log, 1st May 1960. Studying my maps, blue for route, red for target areas. There'd be no ground control to guide me. In flight, you'd get your bearings off local radio stations. I sat there waiting. Takeoff delayed a half hour, then an hour. The heat was terrible. My suit was drenched with sweat, waiting for clearance, authorization from the president himself. I think we all knew we were pushing our luck. I think he knew too. Earlier, I'd plucked up the courage to ask intelligence, what happens if we're shot down? The answer wasn't reassuring. He said, tell them everything you know, they're gonna get it out of you anyway. And he handed me a silver dollar with a pen hidden inside, laced with cyanide. Six local time, and I'm airborne. The air outside is below freezing now. I'm aware of the crate I'm flying, U2 number 360. It's a dog, always some glitch or other. Crossing over Soviet airspace, and almost at once, far below me, I see the condensation trail of a single-engine jet aircraft moving at supersonic speed, and means they've got me tracked. From now on, I'm on radar, and it's not a comfortable feeling.
Far below in Russia, the Soviets were celebrating May Day. In Moscow, the annual parade marked the 43rd anniversary of the revolution. On the surface, things seemed calm. The banners spoke of peace, and in just 10 days, Khrushchev was to meet Eisenhower for summit talks in Paris. But Khrushchev was under great pressure. His communist allies in China were angry with him for getting too friendly with the Americans. Cutbacks had left his army demoralized. His personal power was under threat. And meanwhile, he'd been informed that once again the Americans were sending their spy planes into Soviet airspace, each, in his words, spitting in the face of the Soviet people. He'd ordered one shot down at any cost. Pravda, in the hyped-up tones of Soviet propaganda, reported later what happened next.
With the alarms ringing across the southern Soviet Union, the fighting men in charge of the grim machinery for defending our airspace are ready in an instant. In Sverdlovsk, on the radar, the blips of the pirate plane register, barely visible. Time seems to stand still. So slowly do the seconds before the execution of the battle task flow. Then the commander gives his order. Destroy the enemy plane.
Tried to reach the self-destruct, but the plane was already spinning. The centrifugal force is so great, I could barely hold on. Next thing I remember, I was floating downwards. The Russian countryside laid out below me. I landed in a field, and I remember a Russian farmer approaching me. That must have been a strange vision. And so my journey into captivity began.
Значит, по указке правящих кругов США под судимым Фрэнсисом Гарри Пауэрс на самолете У-2 ранним утром.
Years later, Gary Powers became something of a hate figure in the American press. His failure to self-destruct the plane His failure to use the cyanide pin, the way he admitted so much at his trial.
Do you plead guilty to the charges listed?
Yes, I plead guilty.
Some people speculated maybe he was drugged, but he wasn't. Within reason, the Soviets treated him well, but he wasn't briefed for this. The truth was, no one had expected a pilot to survive. For the CIA and for President Eisenhower, his very existence in Russia was an acute embarrassment.
On display in Moscow, the wreckage of Power's U-2 reconnaissance plane, for Muscovites and foreign newsmen to see, as the Soviet launches its most belligerent anti-American propaganda barrage in recent years. The spy plane incident on the eve of the summit was seized upon by the Kremlin and blown up to proportions that startled and shocked the outside world. Khrushchev himself at the Moscow press conference...
Khrushchev had played a brilliant propaganda game. First, he'd broken the story, but just a little, hoping Eisenhower would deny it. Eisenhower had walked into the trap. He'd tried a bluff. Only then had Khrushchev revealed the evidence. The film from the spy cameras, and Powers himself. Eisenhower, caught in a lie, apologized, and Khrushchev withdrew from the Paris summit in a show of righteous anger. In front of the world's media, America stood condemned. But as Gary Powers reflected later, there were compensations.
I think, to be honest, in May 1960, America woke up some. Some cherished illusions were shot down with my U-2, that the United States was too honorable to use espionage for a start. Was it so damaging to lose such illusions? In fact, I think when many people heard that we were spying on Russia, their reaction was the same as mine. Pride, that we could carry out an operation of such boldness, relief, that we weren't asleep, weren't totally unprepared. If anybody asked me would I do it again, I'd say sure. But this time, let's not get caught.